So the first question, have you ever visited Russia before?
Okay, I've been to Russia twice. I studied at the Diplomatic Academy in Vienna because I thought, you know, if you do philosophy in German-speaking countries, you normally don't get a job in academia, so I needed a plan B, and going to the Foreign Service was my plan B, and then an exchange with the Diplomatic Academy in Moscow, so I spent a summer in Moscow. And we also spent one very short weekend in St. Petersburg, that was in 2005. And then I had another, well, basically just an afternoon in the Hermitage in 2013. So these were my encounters with Russia.
So you have a long history of the relations with Russia somehow.
Well, at least I've seen a little bit, yeah.
Could you tell, please, about your academical research and your interests, and on which themes do you work in the last recent years?
So I'm mainly working on time and space in the ancient world and motion. So I've finished 2 years ago a book on ancient natural philosophy that focuses on how ancient science came about as a respectable field, so to say, that was really given its fundament in Aristotle's physics. I'm currently working on a book on ancient notions of time from Homer to Plato. And I'm also working on a small book on space and how that develops from basically Hesiod up to Plato and Aristotle.
In your opinion, does the research about the antique philosophy and the education of the antique philosophy gives some kind of is it useful or not useful for the modern society? Does it give some lessons? Mm-hmm. What effect does it give on the puts on the society? Is it positive, negative?
Right. Well, of course, I hope it's positive. And I think it can help us not only to develop a sense of how important history as such is, that several subjects do that, but I think ancient philosophy also shows us that for the big questions in human lives, we're still dealing with the same big questions. Questions like, what is the good life for a human being? How can we lead this good life? What's important for that? How important are virtues, for instance, for that, and friendships, and these kind of things? Questions like, what is there in the most fundamental sense, right? What's the ultimate reality? Why is there something and not nothing? I mean, all these questions that came up in ancient times, I think that they're still the ultimate questions we ask in philosophy and we ask as human beings. So I think that ancient philosophy in some sense gives us a freshness to this question and shows us that we are really continuing a conversation over 2,500 years.
And what about the state in your country? How is the level of the antique studies? Is it developed? And actually, what place the studies of antiquity have in your country?
I mean, I take it by my country. You mean the country where I'm teaching?
So, yes, yes.
Yeah, I'm from Austria, but
yes.
I teach in the UK.
Yes.
So in the UK, ancient philosophy tradition is a strong subject. But recently, unfortunately, the philosophy departments in the UK have become quite ahistoric. So basically, they are not interested in the history of philosophy, be it ancient or more modern, but only in completely contemporary stuff, and ancient philosophy is pushed into classics departments only. Now, of course, it's important that you also have ancient philosophers in classics, but if you don't have them in conversation with the philosophers, I think that also has effects on fields and has of ancient philosophy, and it has a big effect on field of philosophy because it basically kind of cuts off its own history. So that's, I think, what's happening at the moment in Britain.
Imagine if you have a possibility to influence and to change a little bit the system of antique studies. How will you change it and modify it? To which side? What will you improve? What do you think is necessary to be put in the actual studies for ancient?
So I think on university level, I would think it would be important that all universities have something, at least like an introduction to ancient philosophy, so that students know it's out there, right? And this is something they may enjoy. I mean, they may not want to come back, but some of them will, because there's, you know, for instance, there's quite a few departments now in the UK that don't offer any ancient philosophy any longer. And then, obviously, in school, I think there's quite a lot of texts, especially by Plato. I mean, take a text like the Euthyphro. I think that's a text that came read at school, and that school children, not all of them may enjoy it, but some of them may find it really interesting, and I think it gets them going and asking these kind of philosophical questions. So I think it would be very useful to introduce some of these very accessible ancient material already in schools, which is, you know, that you have a few schools in the UK, but they are very privileged schools where you would find that.
Mm-hmm. And about this conference, which topic will you take for your speech, and why have you chosen this topic? Why have you taken this sphere of research for this conference?
Right, okay, so I'm going to talk about Plato's understanding of chronos, what's considered as time, in the Timaeus, and its centrality for later accounts of time. My understanding of the conference was that we should not only look at Plato from the title, but also its influence later on. And I think that Plato's account of time in the Timaeus is absolutely basic for later accounts, because I think before Plato we have no uniform framework of time, we have no uniform conception of time, we have lots of different temporal notions, but they're not connected, they have nothing to do with each other. And Plato really gives a big synthesis. And whatever happens to our understanding of time later on, obviously, you know, Aristotle is important, and then there's important questions by Augustine, and there's important new things that come in, obviously, in the 18th century, and then modern debates are quite different. But they all rely on this basis that we have a uniform framework, so that whatever happens can be put in a temporal relation to each other. Right? There is no event that is, so to say, has its own temporal structure and cannot be compared. Everything that happens can be said to be either before or after simultaneously as any other event or process, right? And I think we only get that with Plato, and that's, so to say, a basis for all later thinking about time, and that's why I chose it.
Do you think, for example, there is a common thought that, for example, the 20th century is like the transgression of Platonism, yes? And all fields like the comprehension of time, space. Do you think that Platonism was transgressed? Or do you think that the authors who was pretending to overcome Plato as they were pretending, like Heidegger and Nietzsche, actually stayed in the field Plato was working?
Okay, interesting question. So I think that obviously, you know, some later authors raised very interesting criticism to certain Platonic ideas. I mean, Heidegger is an interesting one because, in some sense, sometimes being at times starts with a quote from Sophist, right? So it is very important, and he thinks actually that Plato doesn't make the mistake of not distinguishing between sign and scientist. But Nietzsche obviously is a big critic of Plato and his jenseits world. I think there's obviously some problems with the way Plato conceives of the forms. I mean, I think, you know, they are there's a starting point for something like universals, but they have some features that later on people thought can't work like this. There may be a problem of self-predication and so on. But I think there's some basic things that Plato set up, in some sense structuring the field, that were not put into question. So that, you know, all the critique that comes out is then a critique of this particular way of, you know, filling in this field. But the way the field was done, that Plato kind of circled around, I don't think that this was put into question.
Like a topos.
Sorry?
Topos.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And the last questions, which concerns actually the atmosphere in St. Petersburg. What is the atmosphere of St. Petersburg for you, for a foreigner who comes here for the conference? How do you feel it? How can you describe this atmosphere?
This time didn't have much time yet to see much of St. Petersburg, but it's just a wonderful city to walk around. We were just, you know, yesterday going for dinner along the canal and then Nevsky Prospect, and I think it's just such a beautiful architecture, and it has both. On the one hand, it's a very uniform. So it's not just going from one flash to the other. It has some uniformity to it, but at the same time, lots of variety. So I think it's a perfect way of structuring an inner part of a city. In some sense, it feels a bit similar to my hometown, Vienna, or also to Stockholm or so, but it's clearly an extremely beautiful city, and one where you feel just calmed by the beauty, I think.
And please wish something to Russian colleagues.
okay, well, I hope that there will be lots of interactions between Russian colleagues and colleagues from other parts of Europe and also America, and that the academic work at the moment can flourish in a free form.
Thank you so much.